Welcome to the 19th Century Novel Podcast, Episode 15, Mary Elizabeth Braddon, Lady Audley's Secret, Part 2. After Robert Audley mentions he has, in his chambers, handwritten letters from Helen Talboys, Lady Audley quickly departs for London. Learning her destination, Robert too boards a London-bound train in Essex, catching an express and setting himself comfortably in a corner of an empty first-class carriage, coiled up in a couple of huge railway rugs, and smoking a cigar in mild defiance of the authorities. What's a railway rug, you ask? I'll let Wikipedia explain. Some carpet bags could also serve as a railway rug, a common item in the 19th century for warmth in drafty, unheated rail cars. The rug could either be opened as a blanket or latched up on the sides as a traveling bag. And so, comfortably coiled up in his railway rug, Robert heads to London. Braddon's characters frequently travel by rail, which had become ubiquitous in England, fundamentally altering people's lives. In one trivial instance, fox hunting of the kind that is enjoyed at Audley Court became more popular, appealing to women and to members of the middle class due to the ease of rail travel. Fox hunting enjoyed a golden age between 1850 and 1875, explains K. Theodore Hoppin. It was above all the railways that allowed this to happen. The number of people hunting grew substantially. In hunting for the truth of George's disappearance, and in disrupting this hunt, both Robert Audley and Lady Audley rely on rail travel, which had become commonplace by the time of the sensation novel, the miles of rail in Britain having grown from 1,400 in 1840 to 9,000 in 1860, with the number of passenger journeys increasing from about 160 million in 1860 to more than 300 million a decade later. Rail travel plays an important role in the other two sensation novels I've examined in this podcast. In Ellen Wood's East Lynne, the female protagonist is seriously disfigured and loses a child in a train wreck. In Rhoda Broughton's Cometh Up as a Flower, the female protagonist is forced to spend a night in a country inn with an unwanted suitor after the horses pulling their carriage are spooked by a passing train. Nicholas Daly, chair of Modern English and American Literature at University College Dublin, sees the railroad as a sign of a new, fast-paced, and dangerous modernity, and the sensation novel as reacting to, and even embodying, this disorienting change. The sensation genre, he writes, is an attempt to register and accommodate the newly speeded-up world of the railway age. The critical reaction to the sensation novel, he argues, mirrored the reaction to the growing rail system, both of which were overturning convention. The heated response to both the railway and the sensation novel suggests difficulties in accommodating a specifically modern form of sensory experience. For Daly, the inescapable forward momentum and excitability of the sensation novel parallel the movement of rail travel. In both cases, Daly elaborates, the subject is thought to be reduced to a position of passive reception, but also to be overstimulated by this experience, to be rendered uneasy, even fearful. Both Robert Audley and Lady Audley take advantage of rail travel, a skill that reveals something about their natures. From sedentary to peripatetic, from couch to coach, Robert is transformed as he travels to Essex, to Liverpool, to Southampton, to London, to Hull, and with George to Portsmouth, followed by a ferry to the Isle of Wight and a carriage to Ventnor. To Beth Seltzer, academic technology specialist at Stanford University, the careless, time-wasting Robert Audley of the novel's first chapters is transformed into a productive member of modern society by his adaptation to modernity's disciplines, He allows himself to be forced into rapid motion and physical activity, and he learns to follow time-based schedules. Lady Audley, too, possesses these skills. Her ability to manipulate modern technology allows her, at least temporarily, to outwit men like Robert. Popular culture often depicted women as confused by the demands of rail travel, and often in need of a man's assistance to negotiate its difficulties. That's not true of Lady Audley. Speed, mental acuity, and a precise grasp of the modern world around her, writes University of Roehampton senior lecturer Louise Lee, make Lady Audley more than a match for her male pursuers. She negotiates the outside world, the world of the railway, the world of half-built London streets, and of gloomy, deserted provincial housing with the same airy insouciance and confidence as if she were ambling through her own bedroom. Traveling alone by train, women such as Lady Audley gained some freedom of movement, the angel freed from the house. On the other hand, rail travel allowed people to live farther from town, denying homebound married women the invigorating features of city life. The English physician Andrew Winter, in his 1875 book, The Borderlands of Insanity, addressing the causes of bourgeois wives' excessive drinking, believed that the psychological impact of their isolation, their hysterical depression, was caused by the railway, which may be said to have driven female society farther and farther into the country. The man goes forth to his labor in the morning and returns in the evening, leaving his wife during the whole day to her own devices. She no longer has access to that intensely feminine refreshment, shopping, to solace her ennui. Winter strikingly anticipates the alienated suburban housewife of the 1950s and 1960s, left alone in a landscape of banality, turning not to sherry and brandy, but to martinis and glasses of wine. As well as consuming brandy, women in the 19th century were the primary consumers of laudanum. According to André Dynjako, senior lecturer in English literature and culture at Warsaw University, women made a substantial part of the addicted Victorian population and were, as a rule, more medicated than men. A number of patent drugs and proprietary medicines containing opium or its derivatives were called women's friends. Doctors prescribed widely opiates for female troubles associated with menstruation and childbirth, or fashionable female maladies such as the vapors, which included hysteria, depression, fainting fits, and mood swings. Likewise, women in the mid-20th century were the primary consumers of the newly developed tranquilizers Miltown, Valium, and Librium. Women's addiction to drugs and alcohol was in large part due to the confining lives society imposed upon them, angels in the house and housewives in the suburbs. Winter recognized that arrangements of society and the railways have banished our wives from all the amusements and excitement of town, concluding that to lessen the problem of female addiction, women needed a more compelling education to provide them with intellectual fulfillment, but only after the humdrum housekeeping labors for the day are accomplished. One might ask why women, especially if they had governesses or were childless, couldn't, like their husbands, simply take the train into the city. One reason was that in doing so they risked being sexually assaulted. Anna Despotopoulou, associate professor of English literature and culture at the University of Athens, drawing from a variety of newspaper accounts, reports that ladies were subjected to embracing, kissing, fondling, molesting, violating, and beating, or, in milder cases, to language described as disgusting, disgraceful, indecent, or brutal by passengers deemed maniacs, ruffians, drunkards, or scamps. Things could be no better for a woman walking alone on a city street. Writing in 1880, Mark Twain observed, "If a lady unattended walks abroad in the streets of London, even at noonday, she will be pretty likely to be accosted and insulted, and not by drunken sailors, but by men who carry the look and wear the dress of gentlemen." However much these accounts might be exaggerated and might be expressions of a moral panic generated by a too rapidly changing culture, there's no doubt that a woman traveling alone faced threats of assault. Both rail travel and shopping in fashionable locales, such as London's West End, also meant an uncomfortable mingling of classes. Unlike many a cosseted upper-class lady, Lady Audley risks being accosted, mingling with the lower classes, traveling the rails, and traversing the city streets alone. Robert runs into Lady Audley at a London train station. He has just arrived. She is already returning to Essex and Audley Village. Robert notices a change in her demeanor. Whereas at Castle Inn she'd appeared a childish, helpless, baby-fied little creature, she is now bold and self-assured. She is altogether a different being to the wretched, helpless creature who dropped her mask for a moment and looked at Robert with her own pitiful face. She looked at him for a moment with a smile, which had something defiant in its brightness. "What has happened to cause the change?" Robert asks himself, only to find the answer when he reaches his chambers. Lady Audley has contrived to enter his rooms and take away the letters whose handwriting, presumably, would have proved that she and Helen Talboys are the same person. "Oh, George Talboys, am I ever to come any nearer to the secret of your fate?" cries Robert. "Am I coming nearer to it now, slowly but surely? Is the radius to grow narrower day by day, until it draws a dark circle round the home of those I love? How is it all to end?" Robert feels defeated. He can't even console himself with reading his beloved French novels. When he opened a volume of Balzac, his uncle's wife's golden curls danced and trembled in a glittering haze. But as he contemplates his next steps, he discovers among George's possessions a book with three inscriptions. The first from its original owner in 1845, the second from this owner to Helen Maldon in 1850, the third from Helen Maldon to George Talboys in 1853. "At the sight of this third paragraph," writes Braddon, "Mr. Robert Audley's face changed from its natural hue to a sickly, leaden pallor." Before further pursuing the truth about George, Robert decides he must save Georgie from his unhealthy life with his grandfather, Captain Maldon. And so he travels to Southampton, to the impoverished neighborhood in which the boy is being raised. Although scholars have, understandably, focused on the sensational aspects of this novel, especially its gender concerns, class division and exploitation are also a frequent concern for Braddon. She explicitly critiques the class divide in Britain, describing the painful living conditions of the poor. Maldon lives in one of those dreary thoroughfares which speculative builders love to raise upon some fragment of waste ground hanging to the skirts of a prosperous town. Walking to Maldon's home, watching a child's funeral procession as it leaves one of the ramshackle houses, and recognizing the connection between this poverty location and disease, Robert resolves that the poor child shall not sleep another night in this wretched hovel. Childhood mortality is so common here that 6-year-old Georgie had attended several infant funerals in the neighborhood and was considered valuable as a mourner, and had come to look upon the ceremony as a solemn festivity in which cake and wine and a carriage drive were the leading features. In this passage, one worthy of Dickens, Braddon shows that for a child growing up in poverty and inured to death, funerals are a welcome festivity. Besides telling Maldon he'll be taking his grandson away from this potentially fatal setting, Robert accuses him of having lied about George's sailing to Liverpool. Robert lets him know that he found the burned telegram, which had warned Maldon of his arrival in search of George, and he declares that at 2 o'clock on the 7th of September, George Talboys was seen alive and well at a house in Essex. I believe that my friend never left Essex, and I believe that he died on the 7th September last. Robert takes Georgie away, arranges for his schooling at Mr. Marchmont's Academy for Young Gentlemen, and, remembering his own childhood dislike of dinners of bread and milk and mutton, provides him with a hotel restaurant dinner consisting of a little vegetable soup, some stewed eels, a dish of cutlets, roast pheasant, and a pudding, all washed down with Bass's pale ale. Exactly what we'd feed a hungry 6-year-old today. Braddon next takes us to the home of Mr. Harcourt Talboys, George's father, whom Robert visits to discuss what he believes is his son's murder. Mr. Talboys bases his life on classical Roman stoicism, on the cold application of logic, and the denial of feelings. He had, writes Braddon, no curves in his character. He is proud of his strong and unwavering moral code, his never having admitted the idea that circumstance might mitigate the blackness of wrong or weaken the force of right. When Robert tells him he believes George is dead, his father responds by accusing his son of running a scam to regain his father's feelings and fortune. The disappearance was a clever trick. George is not dead. He is keeping out of the way for the purpose of alarming me, of trifling with my feelings, and of ultimately obtaining my forgiveness. He will not obtain that forgiveness, however long he may please to keep out of the way. Harcourt Talboys remains angry that his son married the daughter of a drunken pauper, and he dismisses Robert's narrative as a conspiracy against myself. Throughout this interview, George's sister Clara has sat unmoving and unresponsive next to her father. Receiving no empathy or concern from George's family, Robert decides to give up his detection. Why pursue George's fate if his own family won't? Case closed with no resolution, Robert climbs into his carriage, about to leave the grounds of the Talboys estate, when he spies an apparition, a woman running and waving a handkerchief in her uplifted hand. It's George's sister, Clara. "Let me speak to you," she implores. "I believe what you believe, and I shall go mad unless I can do something." She asks for the name of the woman Robert believes killed George. But Robert says he can't tell her until he can prove his suspicions. Her eagerness to help find her brother's murderer, Robert recognizes, is no transient womanish enthusiasm which would give way under the iron hand of difficulty. "Let mine be the hand to avenge his untimely death," she intones, so unlike the typical passive angel. Robert is dazzled by Clara, staring at her with awe-stricken emotion, and he is overcome by her beauty, which was elevated into sublimity by the intensity of her suppressed passion. She was different to all other women that he had ever seen. His cousin was pretty, his uncle's wife was lovely, but Clara Talboys was beautiful. Upon his return to his dreary bachelor quarters, Robert, still captivated by Clara, goes through a long interior monologue about women and marriage and the meaning of life. He, in fact, has something of an existential crisis, despairing at the inconsequence of life, of its emphasis on the material and the proper, feeling an unreasoning rage against the mute propriety of chairs and tables, the stiff squareness of Turkey carpets, the unbending obstinacy of the outward apparatus of existence, and sensing the nothingness of everything, and the folly of taking too much trouble to walk upon a road that led nowhere. The way out of this crisis, it seems, is through Clara. I accept the dominion of that pale girl with the statuesque features and the calm brown eyes, Robert concludes. I recognize the power of a mind superior to my own, and I yield to it and bow down to it. But this surrender causes Robert to consider the confining nature of marriage and the controlling nature of women, what he calls a petticoat government. Women, according to Robert, are concerned only with surface appearances and have no appreciation for the deeper truths of life. A woman goes through life as if it were a pageant. She dresses for it and simpers and grins and gesticulates for it. She pushes her husband into a career, making him into something that she wanted him to be made. The square men in the round holes are pushed into them by their wives. He concludes by telling himself they are the stronger sex, the noisier, the more persevering, the most self-assertive sex. They want freedom of opinion, variety of occupation, do they? Let them have it. Let them be lawyers, doctors, preachers, teachers, soldiers, legislators, anything they like. But let them be quiet, if they can. I hate women. They're bold, brazen, abominable creatures, invented for the annoyance and destruction of their superiors. What are we to make of such a strange misogynist rant? On the one hand, this passage reflects male anxiety about the potentially changing status of women, a concern much in evidence in the 1860s, a decade which would conclude with the publication of John Stuart Mill's The Subjection of Women. Braddon is mocking this male anxiety, this perception that women, confined to narrow roles and denied even the right to vote, are actually the dominant force in society, that in beginning to gain some few rights, they seek the destruction of men. On the other hand, some of this passage reflects what Braddon, independent, self-supporting, and unconventional, likely felt about the superficiality of middle and upper class women. And there's a third reading of these lines, one that depends upon our understanding of the relationship between George Talboys and Robert Audley. Critics have pointed to the homosocial nature of this relationship, especially from Robert's perspective. When they encounter each other on a London street, George exclaims, "You don't mean to say that you've forgotten George Talboys?" "No, I have not," replies Robert, with, writes Braddon, an emphasis by no means usual for him, and then hooking his arm into that of his friend. After George faints, like a typical Victorian heroine, Robert, like a typical Victorian heroine, nurses him back to health. The following dialogue, from which I've removed some material, further documents their homosocial relationship. "Bob," George said, "where are we?" "In my chambers, dear boy. You have no lodgings of your own, so you may as well stay with me while you're in town." "George," said Robert Audley, laying his hand gently upon the young man's arm, "you must remember that the person whose name you saw in the paper may not be your wife." He shook off Robert's restraining hand and, rising from the bed, walked straight to the door. "Where are you going?" exclaimed his friend. "To Ventnor to see her grave." "Not tonight, George, not tonight. I will go with you myself by the first train tomorrow." Robert led him back to the bed and gently forced him to lie down again. He then gave him an opiate, which had been left for him by the medical man. This fond care for one another is repeated when Robert goes through George's possessions after his disappearance, handling the things with a respectful tenderness, as if he had been lifting the dead body of his lost friend, laying out the neatly folded mourning garments, his pipes and crumpled gloves from a Parisian maker, his old perfume bottles and letters and books. These particular items, garments and gloves and perfume, suggest an intimacy between the two men, an intimacy made explicit when Robert asks himself, "Who would have thought that I could have grown so fond of the fellow, or feel so lonely without him? I declare that I would freely give up all, and stand penniless in the world tomorrow, if this mystery could be satisfactorily cleared away, and George Talboys could stand by my side." Further evidence of Robert's gay leanings is seen in his relationship with Alicia. Braddon explains that it might have seemed to other men that the partiality of a young lady who was sole heiress to a very fine estate was rather well worth cultivating, but it did not so occur to Robert Audley. Alicia was a very nice girl, he said, a jolly girl, with no nonsense about her, a girl of a thousand. But this was the highest point to which enthusiasm could carry him. The infatuated Alicia is frustrated by Robert's inability to carry his feelings any further, by his lack of interest in and his total ignorance of her quite obvious feelings for him. She even at one point accuses Robert of having no interest in women at all, saying that Lady Audley is the first woman of whom I ever heard you say a civil word. Alicia might have told him she loved him, Braddon writes, 100 times a day for all the 365 days in the year, but it's doubtful he would ever have discovered the state of her feelings, and her physical charms hold no appeal for Robert. The heavy, clustering locks that clung about her slender brown throat, the red and pouting lips, her turned-up nose, the dark complexion with its bright crimson flush, always ready to glance up like a signal light in a dusky sky when she came suddenly upon her apathetic cousin, all this coquettish, playful brunette beauty was thrown away upon the dull eyes of Robert Audley. These dull eyes will never shine in response to the beautiful Alicia, but Robert does appear genuinely attracted to George's sister Clara. This attraction, though, seems more due to her resemblance to George than to her womanly appeal. "He could see that she was young," Braddon writes, "and that she was like George Talboys. She had brown eyes like George's." When Robert tells himself, "It seems damned lonely tonight," he realizes that if poor George were sitting opposite to me, or even George's sister, she's very like him, existence might be a little more endurable. And there's evidence suggesting that George, too, might have had same-sex leanings. At age 22, he had no better experience of woman than is to be learnt at a flower show or in a ballroom. He views Robert Audley's handsome face. He lives with Robert in London and St. Petersburg. The novel signals Robert's homosexuality in other ways. For one thing, Robert befriended George when they were schoolmates at Eton, and grieves for my old schoolfellow and for the companion who had been dear to me. Boarding schools such as Eton were commonly understood to encourage intimate male-male relationships. As University of Sussex English professor and pioneering scholar in queer studies, Alan Sinfield, explains, "Public schools were crucial in the development of homosexual identity because, despite the official taboo, they contributed, in many instances, an unofficial but powerful cultural framework within which same-sex passion might be positively valued. For another thing, much as Robert's sensibility, his interest in the decorative and the foreign, reads as gay, Jennifer Kushner describing him as a rather effeminate gentleman with a penchant for German pipes and French novels. He wears a blue silk handkerchief around his neck. His apartment is filled with flowers and canaries. And he dislikes hunting, claiming to have hurt his shoulder with a gun." Likewise, Robert Nemesvari, English professor at Wilfrid Laurier University in Ontario, points to the implied significance of Robert's style of dress, his mannerisms, and his attachment not only to French fiction and German pipes, but also to Turkish tobacco. Robert's tendency towards a laconic, drawling irony in his speech, and his complete lack of skill and interest in fox hunting, Nemesvari explains, foreshadow Wilde's quip about fox hunting as the unspeakable in full pursuit of the uneatable. At the very least, a Victorian audience would have associated Robert's habits with the kind of romantic decadence against which the period defined itself. Some scholars have asserted that this equation of effeminacy, this dandyism and decadence with homosexuality, is a more recent phenomenon, developing only after the Oscar Wilde trials in the 1890s. Sinfield, for example, asserting that until the Wilde trials, effeminacy and homosexuality did not correlate in the way they have done subsequently. The trials helped produce a major shift in perceptions, he argues. The entire vaguely disconcerting nexus of effeminacy, leisure, idleness, immorality, luxury, insouciance, decadence, and aestheticism, which Wilde was perceived as instantiating, was transformed into a brilliantly precise image. The philosopher and theorist Michel Foucault goes further, suggesting that the very notion of homosexuality as an identity, rather than as just a sexual practice, was initiated in 1870 with the publication of the German psychologist Carl Westphal's Contrary Sexual Instinct, Symptom of a Neuropathic Psychopathic Condition. Foucault explains that prior to this era, there was no concept of homosexuality, merely a recognition of the act of sodomy, a category, Foucault writes, of forbidden acts. Their perpetrator was nothing more than the juridical subject of them. But, Foucault continues, the 19th century homosexual became a personage, a past, a case history, and childhood, in addition to being a type of life, a life form, and a morphology. In further support of Foucault's thesis, one should remember that it wasn't until 1890, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, that the word homosexual entered the language in the poet and cultural historian and groundbreaking gay scholar John Aldington Simon's book on ancient Greek sexuality, A Problem with Greek Ethics, privately printed in a press run of only 10 copies. Another early use of the word, just a year after Simon's, appeared in the English translation of that catalog of fetishes, Richard Kraft Ebing's Psychopathia Sexualis. Not only does Kraft Ebing use the term homosexual, he seems to have coined the terms masochism and necrophilia, as well as been the first to use fetish in a sexual context. Thus, the sense of homosexual as an identity, it can be argued, resulted from the propensity of 19th century scholars like Kraft Ebing to catalog and classify. In their newly developing field, psychologists classified sexual practices and individual identities in a manner reminiscent of the animal and plant taxonomies used in the biological sciences. On this argument, having a specific sexual identity was the result of scientific practice, not the innate feelings of gay and straight and bisexual men and women. I can't present a definitive argument against these interpretations of the historical understanding of homosexuality. However, I will suggest that Foucault's claim seems overstated. Surely women and men who felt primarily, if not exclusively, a same-sex attraction often defined themselves, that is, fashioned a self-identity, in reaction to and against the dominant heterosexual culture. And such identities were likely shaped and reinforced by same-sex communities in schools and clubs and other private urban locales, to the extent these existed in Victorian Britain. The idea that certain behavioral traits are connected to male homosexuality because of the Oscar Wilde trials likewise seems an overstatement. Some scholarship suggests that the association of effeminacy with male homosexuality came about in the 18th century with the rise of private spaces where men could behave according to their natures rather than to an established model of masculinity. To support this claim, I turn to the satirical journalist Ned Ward, who has the distinction of having been criticized by the Puritan clergyman and participant in the Salem witch trials, Cotton Mather, for being the author of works that were pestilences worse than Egyptian toads. In his 1709 The Secret History of Clubs, Ward provides us with one of the earliest descriptions of the patrons of private gay clubs. "They adopt all the small vanities natural to the feminine sex, to such an extent that they try to speak, walk, chatter, shriek, and scold as women do, aping them as well in other respects. In a certain tavern in the city, the name of which I will not mention, not wishing to bring the house into disrepute, they hold parties and regular gatherings. As soon as they arrive, they begin to behave exactly as women do, carrying on light gossip, as is the custom of a merry company of real women." The effeminate affect of this merry company, David Greenberg, sociology professor at NYU, argues, became widely associated with male homosexuality in the 18th century. Even though it was not shared by all members of the homosexual networks, the high cultural salience of gender and the conspicuousness of gender-linked mannerisms, clothing, and coiffure led observers to regard effeminacy as a key component of male homosexuality. Greenberg continues, "So firmly had the stereotype of the male homosexual as effeminate become established that when 30 men were arrested in a raid on the White Swan Tavern in London in 1810, people seemed genuinely surprised that many had physically demanding blue-collar occupations." The scandal Greenberg refers to consisted of a police raid on a so-called Molly House, which resulted in 8 men being arrested and convicted for sodomy, 6 of whom were pilloried, the other 2 hanged. In 1861, the penalty for sodomy was reduced from execution to life imprisonment. However, notes Ari Adut, assistant professor in sociology at the University of Texas, these homosexuality norms were rarely and reluctantly enforced in Victorian England. Assuming that the stereotype of male homosexual as effeminate, or just less manly, persisted into the Victorian era, we can see how Robert Audley's behavior could signal the novel's readers of his homosexuality. I assume, though, that there was no essential correspondence between effeminacy and male homosexuality, and in fact that the varieties of relationships of male sexual preferences and sexual identities that exist today existed in the 19th century. Susie Steinbach, chair of the history department at Hamline University in Minnesota, provides a useful overview. "Throughout the late 18th and 19th centuries, there was a subculture of sodomites, or Mary Ann's, which was characterized by cross-dressing and effeminate men, and by such social events as a formal costume ball that featured cross-dressed men. But there was also a much larger group of men who had sex with men but did not consider themselves effeminate or sodomitical. Some men had sex only with other men, others with both men and women. Some men lived in marriages with other men. Others were married to women but had sex with men. Others remained unmarried. Male friendship was a flexible and ambiguous concept that encompassed both sexual and non-sexual relationships. Trying to understand the precise character of the homosocial relationship between Robert Audley and George Talboys, which depends upon textual inferences and historical uncertainties, seems all but impossible. In our post-Freudian, sex-dominated, LGBTQ-awakened, pansexual age, we see evidence of sexual desire everywhere, and see denials of such as self-destructive repression. Thus, we can easily project our modern sexual preoccupations onto what may be genuinely non-sexual behaviors and relationships. Robert and George may merely be good friends. But a striking and surprising piece of evidence can be adduced to support the homosexual component of these characters' relationship. Robert's surname, Audley. Braddon might have chosen the name Audley to play on the similar-sounding orderly and oddly. And she might have chosen Audley for its connection to the brother of a Lord Audley, William Ross Touche, who in 1844 was acquitted of attempted murder by reason of insanity. But most likely she was alluding to a notorious instance of sodomy and rape in the early 17th century. A different Lord Audley, Mervyn Touche, 2nd Earl of Castlehaven, was found guilty of raping his wife, more precisely, of restraining her while one of his servants raped her. Or as the trial record reported, Audley was charged for a rape committed against his own wife in compelling her and forcing her to yield against her will to the lust of one Giles Bradway, he, the said earl, holding his wife by one arm and one leg until the fellow had satisfied himself, the earl holding a knife in one hand, which done, the lady endeavored to kill herself with a knife. But they took the knife from her and break it. Audley also was charged with what the trial records called sodomitry, with a different servant, Florence Fitzpatrick, alias Funny. In addition, writes University of Southern California history professor Emerita Cynthia Harrop, the trial testimony alleged Lord Audley was a voyeur. He sodomized other male servants regularly. He encouraged several servants to have intercourse with his wife, and one particular favorite to sleep with his adolescent daughter-in-law, who was also his stepdaughter. He was a sometime Catholic, and he intended directly and indirectly to enrich his servants at the expense of his son and rightful heir. For their crimes of rape and sodomy, Lord Audley and his two servants were found guilty and executed under the provisions of the Buggery Act of 1553. Braddon seems to coyly refer to this scandal when she has Clara Talboys recall the story of some ancestor who was called Audley of Audley in the reign of Edward IV. I have never taken the trouble to remember his achievements. Clara might be thinking of rumors from the 1400s that Isabel Milbury, wife of John Touche, the son of John Touche, 6th Baron Audley, was Edward's illegitimate child. That Braddon refers to this obscure Audley family gossip suggests that, when choosing the name Audley, she must have been aware of its scandalous significance. Clara's musings would have caused contemporary readers to think of the more notorious Lord Audley, whose achievements were well known and well documented, Harrop noting that, in addition to the administrative records of the trial, there are more than 40 extant manuscript renditions, several rhymed libels, and 4 pamphlets devoted to it. Yet one might doubt this incident would remain in the public consciousness well into the 19th century. Who, in the 1860s, would recall an obscure scandal that had occurred 2 centuries before? The answer is, many would. Reviewing Lady Audley's secret in the Times of London, E.S. Dallas, for instance, warned his readers that they may imagine that Audley refers to that most horrible story which appears in the record of our state trials, the story of Mervyn Touchet, Lord Audley, who was beheaded in the reign of Charles I for inflicting on his wife, Lady Audley, indescribable cruelties. Assuming his readers would have been aware of the details of this scandal, and respecting Victorian sensibilities, Dallas does not identify these indescribable cruelties, mirroring the view of the Privy Council's presiding officer 230 years earlier, who in passing sentence described Audley's offenses as so heinous and horrible that a Christian man ought scarce to name them. Further proof that a segment of the British public was familiar with the Audley scandal appears in the March 25, 1888 edition of the Weekly Reynolds newspaper, founded in 1849 by the novelist George W. M. Reynolds, author of the hugely popular Penny Blood novel The Mysteries of London. Reynolds' newspaper, with a large readership in London and the industrial North, was, according to one scholar, the most outspokenly radical paper of the day. In keeping with this spirit, an anonymous writer in Reynolds' newspaper asserting that the House of Lords was not only a useless but an obstructive and dangerous institution, which should be abolished, pointed to the Audley scandal as evidence of its moral corruption, complaining that in the upper house, by its constitution, men like Mervyn Audley, Earl of Castlehaven, who was convicted in 1631 of the foulest crimes that devilry could conceive, including sodomy, the prostitution of his own wife in his presence by servants, and the rape under the most loathsome and unnatural conditions of his daughter, a girl of 12, can sit and legislate. However, it was not the litany of these charges, but sodomy specifically, with which the name Audley became associated. As Tony Scupham Bilton, creator of the Queer Story Files blog, explains, the Castlehaven case would be the sex case everyone mentioned whenever another gay scandal emerged, until the arrest of a certain Oscar Wilde in 1895. It seems likely, then, that the worldly wise 26-year-old Braddon, who had been a working actress for 8 years, would have been aware of the homosexual resonance of Audley, and she would likely have heard recent discussion of the case as Parliament was consolidating various criminal statutes into one overarching bill, the Offences Against the Person Act of 1861, the very year Braddon began writing Lady Audley's secret. In this act, the penalty for sodomy was modified, as the legislation notes under the heading Unnatural Offenses. Whosoever shall be convicted of the abominable crime of buggery, committed either with mankind or with any animal, shall be liable at the discretion of the court to be kept in penal servitude for life or for any term not less than 10 years. The Buggery Act of 1553 had been modified before, in the Offences Against Person Act of 1828, which had maintained the penalty of execution while clarifying that buggery and rape were defined not by ejaculation, but by penetration, or as the Act clarified, offenders frequently escape by reason of the difficulty of the proof which has been required of the completion of those several crimes. for remedy thereof be it enacted, that it shall not be necessary in any of those cases to prove the actual emission of seed to constitute carnal knowledge, but that the carnal knowledge shall be deemed complete under proof of penetration only. Since Victorian censorship would have prohibited Braddon from identifying her protagonist as a sodomite, she encoded his sexuality into the name Audley, a code that would elude censors, but that could be deciphered by many readers. Of course, this raises the question of why Braddon would go to such lengths to suggest a character was gay. Doing so makes narrative sense. Robert Audley and George Talboys were schoolmates, but they don't seem to have seen each other since then. Having had no contact with him for a decade, why would Robert go to such troubles to resolve the mystery of George's disappearance? Why exert this energy and undergo this emotional distress if George were merely a casual acquaintance? Robert would do so if they had shared an intimate bond. Robert's sexuality, in other words, helps explain his emotionally overwrought reaction to George's disappearance, his obsession with discovering George's fate, as well as his utter lack of interest in Alicia. Continuing his obsessive investigation, Robert travels to Audley Court. He plans to confront Lady Audley, but worries that doing so will harm the ailing Sir Michael. When Lady Audley sees him, she looks scared and wan, and cries in a faint, tremulous voice. To assert his power over her and to watch for signs of guilt, Robert says to himself, "I will make her meet my eyes, and I will read her as I have read her before." But Robert's fears for his uncle's life if he were to learn the truth about the woman he loves undoes his plan. Robert makes the mistake of telling Lady Audley that her happiness, prosperity, and safety depend upon Sir Michael's existence, which she instantly perceives not as the warning Robert intends, but as a concession to her power, and which consequently ignites a gleam of triumph in the light of her eyes. She warns him that those who strike me must strike through him. In the coded language they speak, Lady Audley is acknowledging the threat Robert poses to her position, and is reminding him of the threat she poses to Sir Michael. His life depends on her secret remaining secret. His plan thwarted, Robert will leave Audley Court. But first he speaks with Mr. Dawson, the village doctor, who had employed Lucy Graham as governess, and who has just finished ministering to Sir Michael. Robert interrogates the doctor about Lucy's past, reaffirming that she had said she was an orphan, and telling the doctor that he thinks she may not be worthy of being Sir Michael's wife, and explaining that he must trace her life backwards minutely and carefully from this night to a period of 6 years ago, more precisely, from the current year of 1859 to 1853, when George had abandoned his wife to travel to Australia. Robert learns from Mr. Dawson that Lucy had begun work as his governess in May 1856, presenting a recommendation from a Mrs. Vincent, the proprietor of the school where Lucy worked. Robert follows this link in the chain of evidence, tracking down Mrs. Vincent, who, living in London and having fallen upon hard times, carries with her an aspect of genteel desolation and tawdry misery. She tells him that Lady Audley did not visit her when she was recently ill. In fact, she hadn't been ill and didn't send a telegram. Robert also learns that when Lucy Graham arrived at Mrs. Vincent's school in August 1854, she had no references, saying she'd quarreled with her father and wanted to separate herself from all the people she'd known. Robert learns that Lucy was only ornamental, a person to be shown off to visitors and to play fantasies on the drawing-room piano, and handed a bonnet box once belonging to Lucy. Robert removes a label to find another underneath, which he identifies as the connecting link between the woman whose death George Talboys read of and the woman who rules in my uncle's house. The history of Lucy Graham ends abruptly on the threshold of Mrs. Vincent's school. Just what this evidence is, though, Braddon keeps from us for the moment. Since he can't trace Lucy's life any further back in time, Robert decides he must instead take Helen Talboys's life forward, so he boards the train to the coastal town of Wildersnee, where George and Helen had met. He speaks to the proprietor of the town's hotel, who remembers Helen's father, Captain Malden, as a frequent customer of the hotel's coffee house, who knew that George had been stationed nearby, that he and Helen were married in December 1852, that they had traveled on the continent for 6 months before returning, that soon thereafter George departed for Australia, leaving behind his wife and their two-week-old son, that she was very much pitied by folks, for she was very pretty and had such winning ways. Robert also speaks to the woman who owned the house in which Helen and her father had lived. She reveals that after George left, Helen tried to support herself by giving music lessons and succeeded pretty well, but her father took her money and spent it in public houses. They had a very serious misunderstanding one night, and the next morning she left Wildersnee, leaving her little boy behind. And this landlady lets Robert read a letter from Helen to her father, in which she had written, "I am weary of my life here, and wish, if I can, to find a new one. I go out into the world, dissevered from every link which binds me to the hateful past, to seek another home and another fortune." The language here, "I am weary of my life here, and wish to find a new one," is reminiscent of the refrain in Tennyson's poem Mariana, "I am a weary, I would that I were dead." Perhaps this echo of Tennyson is meant to remind us of Helen's abandonment and of her pre-Raphaelite portrait, Mariana having been the subject of a well-known painting by John Everett Millais. Perhaps it's just Braddon drawing language from a popular poem that mirrors Helen's plight. Or perhaps I'm dwelling on what is only a coincidental use of a common phrase, and should therefore continue my retelling of the narrative. This letter is dated August 16, 1854, which prompts Robert to calculate that between the departure of Helen Talboys and the arrival of Lucy Graham at the school, not more than 8 and 40 hours could have elapsed. This made a very small link in the chain of circumstantial evidence, perhaps, but it was a link nevertheless. At this point in our story, we should take a step back and assemble the pieces Robert has collected. In 1852, a teenaged girl named Helen Malden, living in the Yorkshire coastal town of Wildersnee, collaborated with her father to ensnare a wealthy officer, George Talboys, in marriage, alienating George's father, who promptly disowned him. Without this support, George, in 1853, was forced to journey to Australia to seek his fortune, leaving his wife to live with her father and to support herself and her son through piano lessons. In August 1854, Helen Talboys, calling herself Lucy Graham, without references and saying she had quarreled with her father, arrived at Mrs. Vincent's girls' school in London. After a year and a half there, in May 1856, Lucy, saying she was an orphan, was hired as governess for the Audley village doctor, Mr. Dawson. Soon thereafter, she married Sir Michael to become Lady Audley. Upon receiving news that George had returned from Australia and needing to protect her new station and identity, she posted a notice in the Times announcing Helen Talboy's death. When George and Robert visited Audley Court, she fabricated a telegram from Mrs. Vincent as an excuse to travel to London to avoid meeting her first husband. George, though, recognized Helen from her portrait, and the following day went to Audley Court to confront her. That was the last time he was seen. To hide her complicity in his disappearance, Lady Audley sent a telegram to her father, advising him to tell Robert that George had gone to Liverpool, from where he would sail to Australia. Some of this information was used by Phoebe and Luke Marks to blackmail Lady Audley for the money they used to purchase Castle Inn. But this narrative remains more conjectural than evidential, so Robert must dig further. He decides again to confront Lady Audley at Audley Court. When he arrives in Audley Village, Robert, overhearing organ music coming from the village church, wanders in to find Clara Talboys at the keyboard playing a fugue by Mendelssohn, an appropriately foreboding theme for what is to come. For a transcript of this episode, along with the bibliography and other materials, please go to 19thcenturynovel.podbean.com.